Ring. Good afternoon and good evening to some of you who are joining us from Europe. Thank you so much for joining our seminar in Ukrainian studies today. My name is Emmeline Channel Justice. I am the director of the Temerte Contemporary Ukraine program at the Ukrainian Research Institute here at Harvard. I'm so excited today to get to introduce my friend and colleague, Jennifer Carroll, who's our speaker for today's seminar. So Jen and I first met in December of 2013. We were both in Kyiv at that time. And if you remember, December of 2013, that was right in the middle of the Euromaidan protests. So that kind of brokered our introduction to one another. And it was really a strange time to meet somebody who was so engaged in those protests at the same time that I was doing research on them as well. We attended a lot of the same events, had completely different experiences of those exact same events. And that has led us to have, and now I would say, a years long conversation about research and memory and Ukraine and politics. Mm-hmm. And I think it's one of the most fruitful relationships that I've developed in my career. So I'm really excited for you to be here today to talk about your work. And for those of you who don't know, Dr. Jennifer Carroll is a medical anthropologist, a research scientist, and a subject matter expert on substance use in public health. Many of you have been reading her book, Narkomania, Drugs, HIV, and Citizenship in Ukraine, which came out in 2019 with Cornell University Press. That's what we've been reading for our Teacup Book Club this month. The book is an ethnographic study of internationally funded treatment programs for opioid use disorder in Ukraine and the roles played by social imaginations of people who use drugs on Ukraine's ongoing geopolitical conflict and war with Russia. And I'm absolutely delighted to get to add that it won the Helt Prize from the Association for Women in Slavic Studies for the best book written by a woman in the field just this year. So if you haven't read along with us this month, I really recommend the book. It's an excellent ethnography. But today, Dr. Carroll will be focusing on a newer topic in her lecture, which is entitled, What Was Semashko and What Comes Next? Legacy and Innovation in Ukraine's National Healthcare Reforms. Jen, thank you so much for being with us today.
Thank you. Thank you so much for having me. And likewise, this has been a wonderfully, strangely wonderful, fruitful relationship, and I'm so glad to be here. So hi, everyone. Sim dobry večer. It's nice to have you here. So as Emily mentioned, this is a new project. This is something that I really started exploring more in depth in the summer of 2019. As an anthropologist, we have a very important stage of formative and pilot research that we call bumbling around. And that's largely what I was doing in 2019, figuring out what was happening with health reforms, trying to wrap my head around it, really trying to get a sense of how just everyday people living in Ukraine were responding to it and thinking about it. And this was especially an interesting challenge for me because as someone who has done so much work with the international community, with the public health community, the people that I hang out with are inclined to, I think, have a very sort of specific and open view to health reforms that perhaps, you know, folks who don't have a master's in public health from Boston Medical University might not necessarily share. All health policy is really complicated. This health policy is extremely complicated because we are time limited. I'm going to, which reminds me, I need to put my clock in front of me. I'm going to necessarily have to skip some things. Some of those things I'm skipping just because they are less proximal to the story I'm telling. Some things I'm skipping because I'm still figuring out the answer to that question. But I'm very, very happy to go into detail with anything more in the Q&A. And I'm really eager to have this discussion. All right. So the title of the talk is What Was Semashko and What Comes Next? Perhaps not everyone on the call, but most anthropologists will probably recognize where I'm getting this phrase from with Catherine Verdery's book, What Was Socialism and What Comes Next? So Catherine Verdery was one of a handful of anthropologists who were at the vanguard of the American Academy studying Eastern Europe, both Soviet places and immediately post-Soviet places. She did a lot of her work in Romania, but was present for a lot of those transitions, actually started her field work before 1990, and so was really really prominent in theorizing and helping to come up with new ways to talk about complex and unprecedented things that were going on. And we would all be so lucky to have a book that is decades old that still gets quoted in every single thesis about this part of the world. And so in particular, I want to pull out this quote from the introduction of her book, What Was Socialism and What Comes Next, where she really, I think, articulates why it's important to ask those questions, whether socialism is the thing, or the Semashko system was the thing, or democracy is whatever the thing might be. So she says, to investigate these questions, basically any question, it requires a theoretically grounded understanding of the system that has crumbled, and an ethnographic sensitivity to the particulars of what is emerging from its ruins. This means acknowledging that such phenomena as privatization, markets, civil society, and so on are objects of investigation saturated with ideological significance. We must question them rather than mindlessly reinforce them. And a simpler way to put that, which I know I have some students on the line and they've heard me say this almost every day for the last 2 months, but culture is, when you get down to it, is a set of stories that we tell ourselves about ourselves. Privatization, markets, civil society, healthcare, professionalism, these are all parts of those stories. And the way that we tell those stories over time and from place to place and across context varies. And ethnographers are really interested in what does that story look like right here, right now in this place, and how did it come to be that? Right. So very, very briefly, Semashko was named for the first commissar, People's Commissar of Public Health in the Soviet Union, who had that position from 1918 to 1930. The Semashko system, to the best of my knowledge, is really our shorthand, the way that we call the Affordable Care Act, Obamacare. It's not actually called that, we just call it that. But the Semashko system is fundamentally the Soviet system as it was originally conceived and developed. So many of us are familiar with the principles upon which the Soviet Union was founded, this grand vision that was had for a unified, you know, egalitarian sort of world. And this, the healthcare system was designed to embody those values and to address one of the underlying principles behind communism as it was emerging at that time, which is that a lot of the illnesses and health concerns, early mortality, all sorts of things that were plaguing people's bodies were themselves the effects of capitalism, were themselves the effects of capitalist exploitation, and were resulting out of the social system as it existed. So if you change the social system, you're going to eliminate a lot of health problems that the social system produced, right? And so the Semashko system then was like, well, if we have an egalitarian system where everyone has what they need, and like our, if our vision is fully realized, then what do we need healthcare to look like? So the first principle is that it was based on free healthcare for all. It was considered a right and all people should have access to it. Because there was a view that inegalitarian and exploitative capitalist and industrial structures caused so much disease and illness, the focus now turns very much to prevention, preventing illness, preventing disease, and controlling diseases that capitalism has allowed to spread on the ground. Part of that was setting up a structure of local dispensaries, is the English cognate of the term. These are essentially like public health and health settings that would be in different places where folks would go regularly for checkups. They would provide advice like this. This would be the sort of health service that every single person would be able to access. The district physician played a very, very large role in this healthcare system. This was someone who was assigned to coordinate all care in their catchment area. That is, for those who aren't familiar with health policy, catchment area is essentially a geographic bound, sort of like a district or a zip code in which different resources are apportioned. So if you were living in the Soviet Union, the place that you would go to the hospital, or the place that you would go to the polyclinic or to the doctor or the dispensary, was determined based on your address. It's not wildly dissimilar to the ways in which your physical address sort of determines what public school you might go to in certain areas, things like that. So the physician was responsible for everyone in this catchment area, would work in this preventative way with them, and then would be able to refer people up the system as their health needs required into a tiered system of increasing specialization. So before they sent you immediately to the Mayo Clinic, they would send you perhaps to the district hospital or the Rayon hospital, city, oblast, and then finally national as you got more and more specialization. So it was a controlled sort of pyramid of more intense and more specialized care. And I think what's interesting to note here, so I'm not a historian, but Mark Field is an historian who did a lot of study out of the American Academy of the Soviet medical system. Lots of people have written about the Soviet medical system, but his writing is something that I come across a lot. And he made this observation actually in a book that was published in 1991. I anticipate that they wrote the book before 1991 and didn't know what 1991 was going to look like when they had scheduled that publication. But he, in discussing some of the social problems that the Soviet Union was experiencing under Glasnost, he has a lot of analysis of healthcare and made this observation that the original design for Soviet socialized medicine reflected a grand vision and a very, very progressive view. So depending then on which source you go to, whose assessment you trust, it seems from what I can tell, the predominant understanding is that major shifts in the healthcare system started happening around the 1970s. And around that time, Igor Shymin, someone from the High School of Economics in Moscow, was interviewed by the World Health Organization about that legacy healthcare system and how it continues to be manifested in healthcare systems in Russia today. He described that Semashko system by the 1970s as a system, quote, sailing without a captain. And what that meant was that about around that time, this is when medical specialization started advancing, more technologies became available, the average person's understanding of quality healthcare was changing. So the good enough healthcare that was provided by putting a physician in every single district or catchment area and providing essentially preventative service and basic care for all people suddenly became not quite as sufficient as people were wanting. They wanted more advanced care, more technical care. The role of that general physician became supplanted to the role of specialized providers, especially in public opinion. The view was that general physicians just aren't as good as what they do at what they do as specialized providers. And so the role of that physician was reduced as people started self-referring themselves to providers of a greater specialty, and sometimes skipping the district physician altogether. That's the idea that the system is sailing without a captain. So when the district physician doesn't have that same kind of control over where patient trajectories are pointed, you have patients on their own kind of navigating, and it's a bit more chaotic than was originally planned. I know for certain folks who were raised in the United States and are used to our healthcare system with really structured referral systems, getting healthcare elsewhere can be very jarring. I lived in Budapest, Hungary for a year from 2006 to 2007, and I managed to get phenomenally ill while I was there, and had for a period of time, fortunately it largely resolved on its own, but had some really swollen lymph nodes. And a physician told me to go into the hospital and find a radiologist to get some x-rays or imaging done. And I was like, okay, how do I do that? And they're like, just go and knock on the door, which to someone who's Hungarian basically consisted of, you know, I would like two beers instead of one, and I would like my pizza without corn on it. That was an extremely intimidating thing to do. But also we don't do that. So I think that's a very important thing to note about the differences between these two approaches to health and how they actually manifest on the ground when the rubber hits the road. So another thing that really defined this system is the type of healthcare expenditures that were available. I noticed only after the fact that the United States bar got cut off, but these are the percentage of GDP that various countries have spent on healthcare. These are the top few. The United States on this bar is actually 16.9%. We have some of our own problems, but if you think about this as what some of the, you know, quote unquote, most advanced healthcare systems are spending on healthcare for their citizens, it becomes a little bit jarring when you look at the GDP being spent on the original Semashko system. So in the USSR as a whole, when that nation was unified, to the degree that it was unified, 1965, 6.6% of GDP was spent on health, which is already a bit low. By 1970, that had gone down to 4.1%. By 1987, well into Glasnost, it has not gotten any better. By comparison, Ukraine as an independent nation in 2018 spent only 3.5% of GDP on healthcare, which is astonishingly low. And that has a significant number of knock-on effects down the line in the healthcare system. And one of those is this, which I find particularly startling, that in 2018, Ukrainian citizens' out-of-pocket expenses for their own healthcare more than doubled that was expended by the government and came to 7.4% of GDP. So in essence, Ukrainian citizens were paying out of pocket for healthcare that was still ostensibly free because Ukraine continued the Semashko system largely unchanged into its independence, largely up to this day. So they were paying more out of pocket into that system than even the USSR as a whole was paying into that system in 1965. And so that leads us to situations where you get stuff like this. So for those on the call who do not speak Ukrainian, what you are looking at is a bulletin board in the waiting room of a hospital. It is not the highest quality photo because I snapped this with an old cell phone at a hospital in Mykolaiv while literally getting kicked out by a nurse who didn't want to have anything to do with me. It was an unsuccessful data collection day as far as my study of methadone treatment was going, but unexpectedly very productive as far as future pursuits would go. So the poster on the left, says, tuberculosis, it's serious. And it lists symptoms of tuberculosis, says on the bottom, like tuberculosis can be treated and cured. And this is actually very, very similar to the type of COVID prevention messaging that we have probably seen. I'm sure everyone has come across a list of symptoms. Have you had this kind of cough? Have you had this fever? Have you felt bad for this long? This is standard American public health messaging. The reason why standard public health messaging is appearing on a bulletin board in a Ukrainian hospital in Mykolaiv is because this poster was funded by USAID, the United States Development Program, and it was part of a massive expenditure to try to boost tuberculosis testing, treatment, increase laboratory quality, increase treatment quality, and really inspire folks to lower stigma, recognize that this is a treatable disease, and proactively go to get themselves treated. Tuberculosis is endemic in Ukraine, and it's many, many people, even if they are not active, they have latent disease, and so it can be a problem. On the right, we have an ad for personal loans from a local bank, right? And it says that you can get money very quickly. They have a new special with low interest rates. And this is interesting to me because these two posters both sort of contradict one another. One is asking people to be very, very public health approach and think about their own health and wellness and take it in their hands. The other one is like, you're in a hospital. You probably need a loan because the doctor is probably charging you a lot of money for whatever gastrointestinal thing that you need treated or the surgery that your mom has to have or the pills for your daughter, whatever. And that's happening because there is, as we said, very, very little money apportioned to the healthcare system by the federal government, and out of payment pockets for individuals are really, really dominating healthcare funding in the country. So part of the reason for this, in addition to the low GDP percentage that's dedicated to health, is that they have centralized planning that leads to inefficient budgeting and budget expenditures. This could be an entire hour-long talk on its own, but suffice to say that they basically plan ahead based on essentially budgeting is based on the prior year utilization. So that if you're running a hospital, you'll be getting more funds for your hospital based on the number of patient admits you had the previous year. It's also based on population. It is in no way connected to need. And those monies are often usually put towards infrastructure, less so towards the improvement of equipment, less so towards training, less so towards quality improvement. And one of the complicated things that has actually contributed to, in addition to cultural concerns about the vaccine, one of the things that's contributed to the measles outbreak that Ukraine has been experiencing for a while is the fact that the government allocates funds and releases them to be spent in the same year that those medications are actually needed. So as we've seen this year, when an entire country ups and buys everyone out of masks and gloves, it takes time for manufacturers to catch up. And so there might not actually be all of the supply that's needed in the commodity market the moment that it's needed, because there is very, very little planning ahead. In addition to this, physician salaries are irrationally low, and I mean irrational both in a literal and a proverbial sense. In the writing by Mark Field that I quoted a few slides back, he referred to, and this is a bit cheeky, but he referred to physician salaries in 1989-1990 USSR as absurdly low even by Soviet standards. It's a sort of poetic Americanism in that way, but it's important to know that physicians were already deprofessionalized. The medical profession was seen as potentially a risk. Like, they could potentially become a new bourgeoisie. And so there were active steps taken to deprofessionalize doctors throughout the Soviet Union. And as state employees, there were not a lot of raises given to them over the years. And so when I was in Kyiv, I was meeting doctors whose official salary were the equivalent of like $100 or $200 a month. And Kyiv is still a place where, you know, a two bedroom can be upwards of $800 a month. And if you go looking for it, you will find a place that will charge you $15 for a really nice hamburger, right? So this is the cost of living is lower than in many parts of the United States, but it is not that much lower, especially if you're living in the cities. So as a result of this, informal payments are the norm, you know, thanking the doctor for what they have done, and also just outright payments are the norm. So people are expected to either produce or pay for gloves, masks, bed sheets at the hospital, the medication. Even the Ministry of Health has recorded instances in which patients were asked to pay for medication that the state had actually already purchased because the hospital is telling a story like, oh, we're out of budgetary money, we can't do this. And so people go into the exact same kind of financial distress and chaos in Ukraine dealing with unexpected medical emergencies as the uninsured do in the United States. It's a huge barrier to care and it can be really financially devastating. So that's where we come up to now. And the reforms that are happening that are extremely ambitious are all happening in the post-Maidan moment. So as though in keeping with the theme that Maidan, post-Maidan is a time of significant change and things staying the same at the same time, the list that I have put up on the left of the screen is actually every single minister of health that has been operating in Ukraine. They have had six in a period of 6 years, including this bless his heart, Ilya Yametz, who was there for 25 days. But when it comes to healthcare reform, really the big action comes down to these three, Oleg Musi, Alexander Kvitashvili, and Ulana Soprun. These are the three ministers of health who operated, one acting minister of health who operated under Poroshenko in the first Poroshenko presidency. Zoryana Skaletska and everyone after her were appointed by Zelensky, who is the sort of SNL-esque comedian who managed to be elected into the presidency of Ukraine, which is also a whole other presentation. It's wild and frightening and fantastic, really, really interesting thing to unpack. But of these three individuals, healthcare reform really, really started. I think it's fair to say that its roots were in the post-Maidan moment and that there was a huge political will for change. There were many, many young activists, young scholars, young experts who, you know, one of my interpretations of Maidan is that a lot of young people were able to get together and organize and lead these massive protests and kind of left those protests saying, God, you know, we're capable of doing really big things. And I think that there's an enormous amount of credit due to that for the huge explosion of entrepreneurship and creativity that we've seen in the years since the Maidan protests. But this is sort of how it played out. So under Musi, the Ministry of Health begins developing strategies for reform in August of 2014. Mind you, the formal, like Maidan 1.0 ended around March or April. Poroshenko is elected very soon after that. So August 2014, we may even still be in a Yatsenyuk government, but it's very, very early on. And this is sort of when the regulatory framework was established in order to start talking about what reforms could actually be. Kvitashvili takes over in December, and this is someone, there are actually several experts that were brought in from the Republic of Georgia to hold different posts. There was also a Georgian citizen who was naturalized into Ukraine to help with police reform, also a whole interesting story of its own. But Kvitashvili very proactively assembled different panels of experts, folks representing the WHO, UNICEF, and so on to finalize reform recommendations. And those recommendations appeared in this document that I've screen capped the cover of on the right, the National Health Reform Strategy of Ukraine. It's posted online in both English and in Ukrainian and lays out all of the principles that they are hoping to establish in policy in order to bring around health reform in Ukraine. And because they have so many experts coming in from USAID, from the WHO, from UNICEF, we have a lot of, it's a problematic umbrella term, but we have some like Western neoliberal, you know, consumer medicine sort of logic coming into those recommendations, and that definitely shaped what came out. But the primary principles that they were hoping to put in. So like the main subheadings that are in this document are having a truly people-centered, person-centered healthcare system where like money is based on need and the patient's priorities come first, and making sure that the structure exists to support that. That there is patient empowerment, that people feel like they can act, have choice, can speak back, can seek second opinions, that there be a guaranteed package of services. So this is a nationalized or socialized healthcare plan. Actually, it's very, very similar to Medicaid in the United States, in that all citizens will know that the government pays for a specific schedule of services and goods, and that will clarify sort of the state's role, that it will be outcome oriented, that they will be budgeted based on need and quality, not based on how many beds your hospital maintains, and that it will be very implementation focused and really raising the standards of how medicine is provided in that way. All right, so this is Ulana Sopruun. If you have been paying attention at all to what's happening in Ukraine, you have probably seen her face or heard her name. She is famous for being the most famous hated diplomat in Ukraine. And this is part of what was really interesting to me. As I mentioned before, so many of my friends and colleagues and partners and coworkers in Ukraine we're public health people and we live in a public health bubble. I remember even years ago asking someone at a particular NGO, what does the average Ukrainian with, you know, maybe a university education, but no public health training, no medical training, like what do they think about HIV? And the response I got from someone is like, I don't know, man, I live in this bubble where everything makes sense and we have this really curated knowledge. And so all that is to say that the people I knew loved her, but she consistently had the lowest ratings of any politician in Ukraine, which is definitely saying something because Ukrainian politicians as a category are generally not very popular people. Her story is really interesting. So she is a naturalized Ukrainian-American physician. She is an American citizen. And to the best of my knowledge, I actually did not check this if it's still true, but up until at least a couple of years ago, she was on the faculty at the School of Medicine at the University of Michigan. So she's an established practitioner in the United States. She was actually appointed to the position in 2016 by Prime Minister Hoisman to the cabinet after a 3-month vacancy in the ministry. So in April of that year, Hoisman basically just reformulated his entire cabinet. That's when Kvitashvili rolled out of the role. There was no one there to replace him, but Kvitashvili, to his credit, I don't know if it's to his credit, he had been turning in a letter of resignation for months. And there were kind of interesting news pieces about how the Ministry of Health or the government was refusing to accept his letter of resignation. And when people asked him about this, his response was like, I'm still working. I'm still going, I guess I'm still Minister of Health. So I think he was very, very ready to go, but there was no single person who was very clearly appropriate for that job, who would fill that void was very, very unclear. Interestingly, a story that I picked up talking to individuals who are working as either deputy or assistant deputies of health during this time, I don't even know how to independently verify this, but the general understanding was that she was, you know, discovered in a bar, like very literally. So she was in Ukraine, you know, Dr. Sopruun was actually heavily involved in the Euromaidan protests, was involved with street medication. You know, when I went into her office, she actually had pictures of two men in the Heavenly Hundred who died. And she told me that one of them actually like died in her arms. So she has a lot of trauma associated that was deeply involved. And this is part of where her intense commitment to health in Ukraine comes from. But she was in Ukraine, out at a bar with a bunch of expats, as tends to happen when you are there. And allegedly one of the people who was with this group at like the Lucky Pub or like wherever expats are hanging out in Kyiv these days, one of those people was ostensibly an assistant of the prime minister. And over drinks, people were laughing about things. And someone said, oh, Ulana should be the minister of health. She would be great. And everyone was like, ah, Ulana to Ulana. And then like literally the next day she got a call and they were like, would you like to be the minister of health? So that is essentially her ascendancy as it is understood by the people who work directly under her. There were some reforms that happened internally in government staffing that allowed for a complete cleaning of house. So there was a full turnover of Ministry of Health staff once she started, and she pulled all of her staff and deputies in, from civil service organizations. So people who were running different public health sectors were like the former director of the once called All Ukrainian Network of People Living with HIV. It's now called 100% Life. The woman, one of the women that I talked to was working with like a children's health charity and had done a lot of fundraising. So she was essentially taking people from civil service who had shown adeptness and capacity at getting things done and a commitment to healthcare and put them in government positions in healthcare. It fundamentally changed the tone of the ministry. The few times that I visited, Ukrainian was absolutely the lingua franca of the Ministry of Health, but often folks would hear my accent, which I think I will have forever. I always have an American accent, and would immediately switch over to like the most impeccable, impressive English. So these were folks who clearly had an international bent, probably had spent some time living abroad, often had an MPH from abroad, because there's only really one institution that meaningfully provides public health education, which is Kyiv Mohyla. Fabulous program, producing fabulous students, but you know, not something that everyone can go through. It kind of felt like a tech startup, to be honest. I felt like in this ministry building over here, everyone is in the suits and the briefcases. And then over here, they're in like, you know, public health t-shirts and Allbirds and blue jeans. And that was the Ministry of Health. It was a really, really interesting cultural shift. So I think it's important to recall that Ulana Suprum did not create the reforms. The reforms came out of this post-Maidan energy and people who were coming together to facilitate process with external experts before that point. But what Ulana Suprum did do was shepherd a ton of these proposals from, or shepherd the reforms from proposal into implementation in a shockingly short period of time. So in less than a year, Ukraine created a single-payer healthcare system, got the number of hospitals and clinics in the country who had an internet connection, not just a computer, but an internet connection at all, from 6% to 93%, and managed to enroll almost half of the country in the national healthcare system, which is astonishing. And so it's allowed me to become a little snarky with other folks I know working in services like public transit. I have a friend that works for a public transit agency in Seattle, and I keep telling her, why can't I buy tickets on my phone? And she's like, do you know how long it takes to get that system set up? And I was like, well, yeah, I've been to Ukraine. So I think the answer is about 8 weeks. So like, let's get to it, right? So these are the broad features of primary healthcare reform. So the entire healthcare system was not overhauled. They really focused on primary care, which is your family physician, right? The general practitioner that you go to. And then the plan was to implement after the secondary specialty reform and then tertiary specialty reform, and it was going to roll out in stages. This is part of the reason why there was a bit of pushback. A lot of the pushback, especially in Ukrainian media, has been attributed to folks who were finding the old way of doing things rather lucrative and that there were a lot of embedded interest pushing back. But for the most part, these reforms, I think, really, really benefited, especially people who were providing medical care. So briefly, they established the practice of family medicine, period. So currently, general practitioner, family medicine, primary care was not a specialty that was recognized in Ukraine. And there has actually been a lot of contracting out to different groups. USAID, for example, has led a ton of trainings to get people sort of brought up to snuff in international standards of primary care. There's some really, really interesting stories that you can read about trainings in Kharkiv and different places where doctors are doing sort of train the trainer to get other people up to speed and credentialed in family medicine. And that's to essentially reestablish a gatekeeper as well. So while there are plenty of places that Americans like to celebrate for not having these sort of hindrances in healthcare, one of my favorites is I think it's a Twitter post that circulates a lot whenever people start discussing American healthcare online. And it's someone who was like, I ended up, you know, finding a lump when I was in Iceland, and I didn't know what to do. And a friend said, go to a cancer center. And I said, okay, how do I go to a referral? And they said, what's a referral? and it's supposed to be this, like, you know, magical thing. But the referral system also stops a certain amount of chaos from happening when people are diagnosing themselves. It's kind of the equivalent of everyone showing up at the ER, right? As opposed to going to a primary physician who can triage them into the right place. So creating this specialty was an attempt to reestablish that gatekeeping and triage system in order to not only improve efficiency, but to improve the quality of patient care so that folks aren't showing up to clinics and getting treatments that they don't need. The second one, and this is largely the most significant, especially as changes that would affect the actual healthcare that individuals receive goes, they created a money follows the patient model. This is in fact almost identical to the Medicaid model that currently exists in the United States. And if you Google that phrase, you'll actually find a lot of programs called money follows the person coming out of, you know, the states in America and the Southeast, because that's how they're understanding their Medicaid system to work. Essentially, it means that money being apportioned for healthcare is not going to go to the hospital. It is going to go with the patient. So the patient goes with the hospital, goes to the hospital, chooses where they go, has patient choice, and then the government healthcare service is going to pay for them, essentially. So they're taking kind of like a national healthcare system or insurance with them. And so to do this, they actually did create a national healthcare service. They established a separate entity that is responsible for contracting with physicians, contracting with hospitals, and basically being the payer, the single payer for all these people who can choose to take those payments apportioned to them as citizen entitlements to whichever hospital or clinic that they want. Right. And so the secondary effect, the knock-on effect of this that is hoped for, is that this will allow a certain amount of market competition to create quality control. Ostensibly, because if you go to a really shoddy doctor, you will choose not to take your healthcare to that person anymore and will go somewhere else. That is based on a lot of assumptions, but that's the general idea. Third, a package of guaranteed benefits so that everyone is totally clear what the state is going to do, exactly what gets paid for, exactly what medications are covered, exactly what procedures are covered. And this is meant to not just clarify the state's responsibility, but also to reduce bribes. So that if one of the things that's actually covered is asthma, and if a physician tries to, say, charge someone for their preventable inhaler, this is supposed to empower the patient to say, the government is paying for that. I don't need to pay you. That's the idea. A co-payment system for things not covered by that package of benefits. And then finally, bringing medical education up to international standards and doing things like granting the right to practice medicine through licensing and things of that nature. All right, so by the numbers, this has been a wildly successful program. By 2018, we have numbers from 2018, not so much from 2019 on, because the Zelensky appointees for Minister of Health have been less forthcoming in sharing some of these statistics. This is not their baby, right, that they shuffled through. And also there seems to be some interesting politicking happening around healthcare reforms right now. And I think we're really kind of waiting to see how this plays out. But by 2018, the end of the year, like 97% of healthcare facilities had joined the reform, which means that they signed up with the National Healthcare Service and was like, hey, we have all the requirements. We have an internet connection. We have this and that. And if you want to send us patients with money, great. 24,000 doctors joined that system as well. And this includes both public physicians and private physicians. 25 million Ukrainians, which is more than half of the country, signed a declaration with the doctor. So the way that this works is someone goes out and essentially establishes care with a primary care physician or a doctor who will act as a primary care physician. And then we have in the United States something called managed care organizations. The physician kind of operates like the managed care organization. So the physician gets paid per patient. Like, we're going to give you this much money for every single person that you sign up and establish primary care with, and then you will use that money to provide checkups, to provide asthma medication, to provide the standard list. And then if their needs go beyond that list, then the government will start picking it up from there. This actually raised some doctors' salaries dramatically from like $100 to $200 a month to more like $2,000 to $3,000 a month, which is, we're actually getting into comfortable, like really, really comfortable living in Kyiv. Tons of prescriptions paid, procurement improved, just like, the numbers look really great. Okay. So what I want to focus on for a minute is this notion of the money follows the patient principle. So as I mentioned before, the National Healthcare Service of Ukraine, the way it was conceived is that the healthcare service empowers patients to pick what facility they want to go to, pick what doctor they want to go to, and then they take money from the healthcare service with them. So that ostensibly will, if we think about this in terms of market logic and neoliberal logic and healthcare as a consumer commodity, this empowers them as consumers to basically vote with their money about what they want their healthcare to look like, what they expect out of their healthcare. And the benefit to the doctors is the National Healthcare Service promises to pay fair market value for the service being rendered. And this is where I think the ethnographic becomes really important. And I want to actually read you an excerpt from my field journal from 2019. This is just one story of an individual who I spoke to about their experience doing this kind of work and navigating this new system, and especially navigating this money follows the patient principle. So I'm going to refer to this person as Alyona. Alyona told me her own experience with the Choose Your Doctor program, as she called it. Her experience was very bad. She said the website was very slow and hard to use. But when she finally got through, the system recommended only a single doctor in her area who was available to take new patients. She made an appointment through the website. That was something the Ministry of Health was very proud of. We're like, we'll inspire confidence by having online bookings and technological, yeah. So she made an appointment through the website and went to the clinic at the time designated to sign a declaration with this doctor. When she arrived, this was a local polyclinic, by the way. When she arrived, the door to the office was shut and no one came to look for her at the appointed time. She knocked on the door and heard nothing, and so sat back down in the waiting area. More time passed, and soon after, an elderly man came as it was time for his appointment and asked Alyona if she had been seen yet. Over the course of all this, Alyona went to the door of the office two more times, and the first time it was simply to see if anyone was even there. She peeked in to see what she describes as an old fat blondinka who snarled, "Shut the door," at her. Alyona spoke about this behavior with real contempt, saying, "Look, if you don't want anyone knocking, just put a note on the door that says, 'Go away.' And how can you even treat people like this?" She said they need a sign on the door that says, "Osторожна злая собака," which basically means like, "Beware of dog." Eventually she went in a second time and insisted that it was time for her appointment. And the lady, very huffy, was like, "Okay, fine." And began barking requests at her, like, "What's your year of birth? What is your familia? Where do you live?" And finally said, "Fine, go get me these documents, bring them back here, and maybe I will sign the declaration with you." So Alyona is thoroughly offended at this point and said something like, "I am sorry, you will treat me like a human with respect to this doctor." At which point the doctor screamed, "Get out," and started ranting, "Why the hell are all you people coming to me?" So on her way out of the clinic, at which she did not receive a declaration with this doctor, Alyona struck up a conversation with some women who were at reception. They began commiserating about the terrible behavior of this doctor, and the women at reception said that the clinic, in fact, used to have many very good doctors, but they left to go work in a private clinic. They gave Alyona a flyer for that clinic, which one of them happened to have in their purse after Alyona asked if they knew anyone else in the area she might be able to go to. They also told her that the doctor she had just seen already had more than 2,000 patients on their roster, which is kind of the maximum at which point physicians can start turning people away, largely because the clinic lost its other providers, and that's why she is so grumpy about receiving all these patients. So Alyona marveled that she would have never found this private clinic where she did end up going and signing a declaration with a doctor that same day. She said it was wonderful. The customer service was excellent. People were kind to her. They served her tea. It looks great. But had she not received this tip from the woman at reception, she would not have known about it. And now this other public clinic with the terrible doctor is now an even worse place. And it's a place that only pensioners would go, which is bad because, quote, they don't even have the internet to Google and find something else, which is double bad. So interestingly, prior to this, Alyona had been receiving healthcare from a private clinic in Kyiv, of which there are many. You can just walk in and pay out of pocket for services. And typically they are pretty good. They're like really, really good healthcare, but it's expensive, right? You get what you pay for. She said that she had been paying quite a lot of her salary to cover various appointments and medications for ongoing healthcare concerns that she had. She has been seeing a particular specialist there for ages who she likes and trusts and has been paying a lot to see. And she says, even though she has a declaration with this new physician at another private clinic that she raved about, which she describes as very nice and customer service oriented, she insists that she will still go to the original clinic for all her needs because she would prefer to pay. And she said that if she is paying for her own appointment, there is an expectation that she can bring to the interaction. She can say, I am paying you, you must treat me with respect, and says that she can't do that with the National Healthcare Service. Right. So when we talk about barriers to healthcare reform, barriers to system change, there's a few things that that I think are problems no matter where you go. One is system inertia, right? And that's the fact that we all prefer to interact with systems and structures that don't change. If you want the simplest example in the world, think about how you feel whenever Facebook updates its interface and you can't find where your inbox is anymore. Like that, we're all irrationally irritated about that, and we want the systems we work with to be stable, right? In addition to that, we have a sort of social inertia. And anthropologically, we call this habitus, which is the fact that structure and practice mutually reinforce each other. We tend to do and keep doing and inspiring ourselves to do the same thing over and over and over again. So if you are changing the systems, that doesn't mean that people are going to change the way they interact with the system. They might still act as though the old system is still there, just because that's how we work as humans. Now, if we think about the structure that was put in place with these healthcare reforms, this is actually a quote from Ulana Saprun in a conversation that we had in the summer of 2019. She said that the separation of policymaking and policy implementation, which is essentially taking the healthcare service and separating it as an entity independent from the Ministry of Health, is, quote, how it should be in a country with a European parliamentary system. And that idea that this is how it should be, that we should allow some of these market forces in to have separation of powers, that leads to a lot of assumptions about how people should be interacting with the system. And this is a quote taken directly from the Ministry of Health website, where they talk about some of their reforms. And I thought that this was a really interesting extension of that logic. They said, now, much depends not only on doctors, but also on patients. Patients should have the courage not to give bribes, to figure out which services are free, to write a request or complaint if a bribe is demanded of them, and to not visit an incompetent doctor or follow instructions they do not understand. Which is actually quite a lot, I think, to ask of people who have been systematically disempowered, taught to not trust healthcare systems. And when I think about that in terms of Aliona's experience, she actually put forth an extraordinary amount of energy that day for her self-interest in order to establish the type of care and maintain the type of care she needed. Nothing that she did necessarily fit within this description, except perhaps not visiting an incompetent doctor. If she hadn't found a new one, she might not have had a declaration at all. But I think it raises a lot of questions. And I want to take us back to the quote at the very beginning of the presentation, in which Catherine Verdery encourages us to maintain an ethnographic sensitivity to the particulars of what is emerging. And that's especially important so that we do not fall into the trap of thinking that this type of commodification of health is just the same way that we commodify health in West Virginia or Azerbaijan or anywhere else. And to be very, very clear that all of these forms are cultural. And as I said before, culture is a set of stories that we tell ourselves about ourselves. And so even though it might look similar on the outside, the stories on the interior of these behaviors can be very, very different. And so this leads me to ask an awful lot of questions about a healthcare reform that, from an economic point of view or health management point of view, appears to tell a very straightforward story, and then subsequently be complicated by, the need to rationalize healthcare demand or the need to re-empower this particular group. Like, those are implementation challenges, but how these reforms are supposed to work feels straightforward, but is it? So I ask these questions, like, how have decades of out-of-pocket payments shaped interpersonal relationships between patients and providers, right? And I don't just mean, what are people used to doing? How are people used to acting and trusting each other? I mean, how does this shape power and choice and agency in these relationships, right? We know through tons and tons of research across time and across cultures that gifting and commodification and commodity fetishism and even just simple systems of asynchronous exchange, which is asynchronous is anything from like apart from I give you your Starbucks coffee, you give me $4 and we're done. That shapes subjectivity, it shapes choice, and it shapes agency in ways that very, very deeply impact how we move through the world. How have new practices, right, the new systems demanded by these healthcare reforms shifted, supplanted, or grafted onto those pre-existing identities? This is something that I paid attention to in a US-based study that I helped out with a few years ago, looking at efforts to bring physicians' opioid prescribing practices in line with national guidelines and recommendations. And what we found was that in these clinics, these were largely clinics, infectious disease clinics treating people living with HIV. In those spaces, the way that pain, because opioids were prescribed for chronic pain in these spaces, the way that pain was established in the clinic was not clinical or objective. It was deeply interpersonal. It was about trusting each other. And it was about like holding your shoulder and being like, yeah, doc, it's like this. And that's really how they came to understand each other in this very discursive, interlocutory way. But if you bring something unquestionable, if you bring something like a urine drug screen, you can't argue with those results. And so if you've been building this subjectivity with your patient for years, and then all of a sudden their urine comes back and the medication you gave them isn't in it, it creates a crisis and people don't know what to do. Does this mean that I'm a bad judge of character? Does this mean that my patient is a bad person? Does this mean that I'm a bad person? And that's a much bigger problem than just the healthcare issue in front of you. I think Aliona's story specifically asks us about this question. So the money follows the patient structure is supposed to, intended to empower patients to apply market pressures in very, very specific ways. It assumes a particular structure of social power that is channeled through a specific person in a very specific way. Is that the case though? Right? In these relationships, where does money actually reside? Because Aliona is telling us that money that comes out of her pocket is very, very differently interacting with the world than money coming out of the coffers of the National Healthcare Service. So where does that power come from? Is it in the money? Is it in the payer? Is it in the very act of doing the paying? I think these are things we need to explore. And then finally, what is care in the context of a changing healthcare system, and how and where do individuals actually seek it out? The system presents certain healthcare services as a commodity, but is that what people are actually doing in order to take care of themselves? And do those commodities, whether it be a service or a medication or a procedure, do they have the same meaning across these different actors? Right. So many, many years ago, when I was a baby student, I presented at a conference at the University of Pittsburgh and had the privilege of having Galina Lindquist as a discussant. I also presented a story of a very, very new project that presented the pathway of one particular woman through methadone treatment. And the feedback I got from Dr. Lindquist was a single swallow does not a spring make. So I do want to recognize that I've brought you limited ethnographic data and to say that I don't think Aliona's story is helping us draw conclusions. I think that it is presenting us with a point of departure to say, what can we do to better understand how these healthcare reforms are unfolding, what it actually means, and to really follow Catherine Verdery's marching orders of not taking concepts like commodification, marketization, privatization as given, but recognize them as things that uniquely, idiosyncratically happen in each new place, in each new way. So I think things that'll be helpful there are this concept of hierarchy of resort that was produced by Lola Romanucci-Ross. And this is the idea that people have escalating strategies for help and for care as their solution gets worse, right? So if you have a sniffle, you stay home from work. If it gets worse, you send your roommate to Walgreens for some NyQuil. If it gets even worse, you go to the doctor. If it's even worse, you go to the ER, right? So those are hierarchies of resort. And how do the different points of entry of the healthcare system fill out those spaces? How are they ordered? What is that hierarchy of resort like? I think Jennifer Patico's work on gifting is extremely instructive here. She's done some incredible work about how the ability to give gifts among individuals who experienced the transition from the Soviet Union into whatever post happened to be wherever they were, how that really disrupted relationships, because there were so many relationships that were not exclusively, certainly, but very much tied to the type of interactions that they had in gifting interactions. Very similar to how now we're understanding that certain relationships come and go with COVID quarantine. I talk to my students all the time about, like, you know, you might've had an acquaintance last year that could have blossomed into a really strong friendship or maybe a romantic relationship, but now we're quarantined and you're in different dorms and you might as well be on opposite sides of the world. I think that's a really good framework for looking at how the relationship between doctors and providers, or providers and patients, are changing when we're changing how money and power changes hands and the meaning of it, right? Is it an economy of payment, an economy of gifting? And then finally, I love this book so much. I've read it so many times, but Stephen Collier, I think more than anything, he looks at neoliberalism as a practice. And he's like, okay, so we love talking about neoliberalism as this set of ideologies and understanding market forces as in really big picture ideas. But he's like, neoliberalism is also the fact that a bureaucrat somewhere has to deal with the fact that we now have a water company who charges people for water, and cities all across Russia that are full of pipes and full of sinks and full of apartments and not a single water meter anywhere, because no one ever needed to count it. The water just needed to be on or not on when it was a centralized service, right? And so now looking at how this commodification of healthcare and these reforms are playing out in the minutia, I think tells us an awful lot about those forms as they're emerging. It allows us that ethnographic attention to what is emerging out of this particular moment. I wanted to close with this. For those who are interested in studying the economic and structural or regulatory changes in Ukrainian healthcare a bit more, these are some of the best sources I found. They are being produced by Tatiana Semagina, who has been doing really strong public health work at Kyiv Mohyla Academy for quite a while. And also Vox Ukraine has done some of the most interesting reporting on it that I have seen for quite some time. So I want to point you there. That's going to be your subject matter expert if you really, really need one. And so that is it. Thank you so much for your time. I'm happy to take any questions.
Thank you so much, Jen. I feel overwhelmed with the amount that I just learned in that short period of time. So in terms of the questions, if you are on the webinar and you'd like to ask a question, please use the raise your hand function, or you can chat me in the chat box and I'll call on you. And if you are watching on YouTube, you are welcome to submit your questions on the YouTube chat box and I'll read them out. If you're in the webinar, feel free to turn your video on. While everyone gets settled, I'll ask the first question. And this is a little bit of, you know, your speculation based on what you've learned so far, but one of the things that struck me from Ayona's story is really the potential for people who have cash to get different services than people who don't have cash. Mm-hmm. And I think one of the things that just pops to mind is the kind of inequalities that might be created by a system like this, where, you know, you have a National Health Service that has a certain promise of what it can do, and you still have people who have the economic capacity not to use that system. Will mm-hmm. that create a kind of stratified, is, or does it have the potential to create more stratification than already exists?
Right. I mean, I think that's the interesting question. And I think that's precisely the interesting question, right? Because Ukraine has already had, in effect, a two-tier medical system for a very, very long time. And, you know, even though I will say the quality of healthcare that's coming out of private clinics is very, very good, that doesn't change the fact that they are very bold about their capitalism, right? Like, one instance I can think of is when I was, I had a short stint as an editor with a USAID contractor. It was an American company. It was kind of helping me like network and pay rent while I was doing field work. And I had to get a physical to work there. It was just a weird company thing. So they also wanted it in English. So I ended up going to American Medical Centers, which is the like bougie English language like place in Kyiv, because I was like, they're going to reimburse me and I just need documents in English. So I emailed them and I was like, hi, I need an appointment. I need a physical, blah, blah, blah. And they were like, fabulous. We will do that for you for $330. And I was like, and I wrote back and I was like, what a pity, because my boss will only reimburse me for $100 to do this. Such a shame, Jal. And they wrote back and they were like, fortunately, we have a special just for one day, $100 for physically, you know? And I was like, this is the most perfect example of things that are happening. And so, I mean, I think that too, that double tier system has been there for a long time. The folks that I know, like Aliona, who's going to the private clinic in Kiev, like she doesn't make a ton of money, but she makes enough to go, right? She's not someone who depends upon the potato field behind her dacha to eat during the winter, right? Which a lot of Ukrainians, especially folks who live outside of the cities, may be. So I don't know. I feel like the reforms were actually designed to prevent that from happening. But this is the point of interest. We don't actually know what forms are going to come out of this, right? This is like human beings are squirrely people, and the structures have been put together, as I indicated from the quote with Saprun and the quote from the website, with like very clear anticipations in mind of what the effect is going to be. And then we just kind of have to wait and see what actually is going to happen. I would not be surprised if we saw new levels of distinction and inequality forming, but I can't really guess where they're going to be. I think we're going to learn a lot about what healthcare in Ukraine was by watching what it's becoming.
I think that's a good takeaway for those of you who are also working on projects that are going to feature this healthcare reform. So we have a couple of questions in the chat, and Mariana, I see your hand as well. So Irene, Maximuk, feel free to jump in if you want to ask your question yourself, but you proposed a question that I also had, which has to do with the COVID situation. You know, how is the system handling that? And I would also just add, what effect is COVID having on the potential to implement these reforms?
I hate to disappoint an audience of this size, but I don't actually know. COVID has been so recent, and I would be lying to you if I didn't say that my own life has been a bit chaotic since COVID started. I was actually supposed to be in Ukraine this summer, as many people on this call probably were. And I'm seeing some like, oh, nods. Yeah. And so, the opportunity to actually learn on the ground, like I'm kind of getting news from the news, as a lot of you all are. So I hope to be able to answer that question more thoroughly as time goes on. I was mentioning to Dr. Channel Justice a little earlier that I'm very, very privileged to be working with some folks based in Kiev and based in St. Petersburg on a COVID-related study. So I really look forward to being able to answer that question in more detail in the coming months, should we all find ourselves together again.
Yeah, I can definitely, done a little, I did a presentation for our summer school students this year on the COVID situation, which was a very, general assessment, but the fallout from that, I think, is going to be pretty long-term. So Patrice Dobrowski asked about Ulana Suprun. She asks, you mentioned that Ulana Suprun is really hated. Is that because of the frustrations in dealing with the implementation of care reform? Mm-hmm. And then the follow-up question is, how was the population prepared for these changes, and was it really prepared at all? Mm-hmm. And what kind of storytelling might help enhance that kind of question?
So I think Ulana Suprun, the sense that I got, and this is something, at this point, I'm able to answer this question not with solid data, but with plural anecdote that isn't necessarily biased. And the anecdote that I have is that, healthcare, Ukrainians hate their healthcare. First of all, I don't know anyone who loves their healthcare, but Ukrainians especially hate their healthcare and have really contentious relationships with physicians because of all of the structural reasons that I mentioned before. And so I think that if you poke that beast, even if you're trying to make it better, you're going to upset a lot of people because I think, especially having been through multiple revolutions, having still being in an active war, having, contested sovereign territories, all kinds of presidents, Yanukovych poisoning someone and then getting to be president later, which is, you're just so prepared for things to get worse, right? And so like I was told a joke growing up that hell is like being in manure up to your neck and everyone is like, don't make waves. And I feel like that's kind of how a lot of people in Ukraine are thinking about their healthcare. So like you're changing stuff is not good. But there were also a lot of individuals. I don't want to call anyone out because I still need to learn a lot more about this. I don't want to mistakenly blame the wrong person, but there were some very prominent individuals in Ukrainian healthcare and politics who were very strong opponents of the reform. The accusations I have heard is that the opposition came largely out of the fact that they stood to benefit significantly from the old system. And that's, you know, Marx wasn't right about everything, but he was right about that. People who benefit from the old system are going to really fight to defend the old system, right? So, but the story that was told about that is like, oh, this is going to disempower doctors. This is going to worsen healthcare. And I think the idea was like, oh, you're not going to be sending money to hospitals anymore. Oh no, you know, and so like different things were sort of catastrophized in that way to tell a story that I think made people feel extremely vulnerable, largely because they were extremely vulnerable. But I do believe that it was based on a lot of misinformation and things like that. As far as the population being prepared, I think Aliona's story provides us with a good example of the spectrum of that is that, like, on the one hand, you have these like really savvy, you know, professional, urban young individuals who are like, I'm going to go to the website, I'm going to download the app on my phone, I'm going to figure this out, I'm going to demand to be treated with respect because I know better. And then on the other end, you have, and I think this is sort of a specter, but of like the poor pensioner who has no internet, doesn't know how to get online, can't look for it. Like their choice is artificially limited by all of the things that characterize their lives and what they have option and the supports that are there to help them navigate, which are largely non-existent. So I mean, I think there's a huge spectrum. I think it's significant that more than half the country has signed up for a declaration with a primary healthcare provider. I also think it's significant that half the country hasn't. And I don't know yet enough to really be able to say what that distinction is, who is who. Tatiana Semagina, I think, is actually actively doing that work, and which is why I'm following what she's up to. But we're seeing a lot of differentiation, and I think we have yet to see how some of that distinction can be mapped out across the population.
Great talk. I just had a question about, I learned through my research in Ukraine how I was very shocked to hear that TB treatment wasn't given in private hospitals. At one point, I was asking a doctor, I was like, oh, so is there any work in a private or public hospital? And they literally laughed at me and said, public, they don't have TB treatment. And so I was wondering how, with the health reforms, like what treatments are being covered by these new reforms and in this two-tier system, and how have you seen it impacting stigmatization of certain diseases, especially because I know opioids are very stigmatized as well.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, again, I think we have to see that play out. I'm gonna give a very sort of pregnant, I don't know, but I bet so, right? Because we are gonna be seeing new kinds of distinction and differentiation. As this one story tells us with Aliona, and I did talk to other people, they're largely echoing very similar things. They were also largely younger individuals, and so are going to come from a particular like ideological standpoint in that way. But we're seeing that public clinics, private clinics, and private clinics that you pay out of pocket for all kind of have different meaning for everybody, right? And so the way in which those meanings are going to compound differences that already exist, especially with these heavily stigmatized diseases, it's going to be interesting. I will say though, and I've told this story a bit recently, and it's a bit self-effacing, but like there's, the government has also started doing things like allocating money towards medications for opioid use disorder, which is astonishing. Like the people have been fighting for that for years, a huge civil society win. And the way that I've been telling the story is that, you know, my Ukrainian's okay. It's pretty good. I get by. And I was reading a newspaper article because something came across my Google feed about this. And I pulled out my dictionary when it was like, the government is funding this medication. I was like, I must be understanding that verb. That can't be, they funded it. And it was like, I'm looking at Google Translate like, funded. It says funded. I'm so confused. So there have been some like really, really major changes, and hopefully there will be greater access. So hopefully that improved access to care will also be a force to reduce that differentiation. But I think we got to see how it's going to play out. Oh, I do want to mention too, Marina Basilevich-Nading, who is a really, really superb medical anthropologist who has also done a lot of work about the professionalization of physicians in Ukraine. Definitely look up her stuff. She posted something to chat, a document about the responding to the COVID-19 pandemic that seems to have come out of the physicians union in April 2020. Marina, thank you so much for that. That's awesome.
Marina, did you want to add something to that, or you have a separate question? Go ahead.
No, I can just briefly say, since you mentioned that COVID question, and I happened to know about this study that was very sociological, just really more quantitative. And it was in the early days of pandemic, so perhaps it doesn't fully capture the experience, you know, over time, but it does give some interesting information regarding just healthcare providers' assessment of their preparedness. And at that point in time, in the early spring, the rates of COVID were quite high in the healthcare providers population. So as high as in Italy, but Ukraine had many fewer cases at that point, definitely indicating that they weren't working in a very safe environment. Yeah, anecdotally also, it's not research-based. I know that providers have described you know, sort of being forced to take extra shifts and like being reassigned to different floors and so on without proper training, without any training, in fact, you know, getting sick and all of that fun stuff. But that has not much to do with the reform, really. It's more about just kind of everyday lived experience, you know, that would have probably been the case even if no reform attempt has ever been made. Yeah, I think just the questions about access, right, that have come up thus far are really good ones. And I was just looking through some of my old papers, you know, when I was trying to understand exactly the nature of the reform as well. And, you know, this guaranteed packet of medical services that would be kind of provided for free was supposed to be calculated in like 2 years' time, wasn't it, Jen? From the rollout of the reform in 2017, the first kind of step. Because some of it wasn't known, like the budget was known, but then the actual demand and then the cost of services are the two things that like needed more time to be figured out. Because as Jen explained, the financing didn't work the same way before, you know? Mm-hmm. So like a facility that, let's say, provided 1,000, like, surgeries, let's say, would be funded maybe in a similar way as the facility that provided like 200 services, you know, to my understanding. So yeah, so they just kind of had to figure out, and I wonder how, you know, if that was done or not, but I haven't been able to find out just yet. I haven't looked. I remember, you know, I did some work with the trade unions, and people were just worried and wondering how that process is going to happen every year. And who will get to decide what's in the guaranteed packet?
Mm-hmm. Thank you, Marina. This is what Marina does. She shows up and says necessary, intelligent things whenever we need. It's fabulous. It's your superpower. I love it.
Yeah, we are really lucky. We have several excellent medical anthropologists here who have been working in Ukraine for a while. So feel free to jump in, or you know, put your hand up if you have any comments, not just questions. One of the benefits from, you know, being virtual is that we get to actually be in a conversation with one another at the same time, which is nice. Mm-hmm. I do have a question from our YouTube audience, from Oleg, who asks, what strategies have proven most successful for Ukraine in bringing effective healthcare to the most vulnerable and low-income patients, including seniors? And I would actually add to this another question that I thought of, which was rural populations. That was something, you know, it sounds, and I'm assuming that of the several anthropologists who are here, somebody's going to look at the stratification potential between these clinics that are, you know, accessible by people who are in cities, who have internet, you know, who go around all the time and have all this knowledge. Rural populations might have a completely different lived experience of this. So I would add rural populations to the vulnerable category. Thanks, Oleg, for the question.
Yeah, absolutely. And I also see a question from Marina Petrova in the chat that is a good one we should get to next. So I do know that there have been efforts to bring telehealth into rural areas, because if you pause to go through some of the public analysis and commentary, especially with like specialized journalists and people who are kind of, you know, having the public, being the public intellectuals about this, these reforms, one of the major questions that comes up is like, okay, now that we're doing this vote with your feet and vote with the government's money thing, like, is this free market or like limited market competition going to bring doctors into rural areas? right? Because not having enough physicians in those regions has been like a major issue for a long time, you know, especially with folks that I have worked with who are seeking medications for opioid use disorder. There are national regulations that I believe they may have been updated in the last year or so, but for a long time, the standing rule was that you could only receive a diagnosis of substance use disorder from a panel of three addiction specialists. And these are not folks who it's not like pediatrics. Like you can't go to a hospital and like find half a dozen of them and like pick the ones that aren't on lunch. Like that actually, you'd have to actually cover quite a large area to get that done. And so the idea that people would even be able to do that is kind of ridiculous. So I do know that there were efforts towards getting telemedicine up and running so that there could be more direct access. I think that there was the potential for that to work extremely well. And I don't mean that as a kind of half critique or half dig. I'm saying like the potential was there. Like a lot more computer services were set up, a lot more internet service was set up. You know, Ukraine is a place where medical records have existed exclusively on paper since time immemorial. And there's even some colleagues of mine at Brown who did a chart review, which is one of the most fundamental, most basic methods of clinical and public health research is just like, let's look at everybody in this clinic that had diabetes and figure out what happened. And did people who get this treatment do better than that treatment? Really basic stuff. And you can do that at an American hospital by like calling the tech office, getting IRB approval, telling them what you want. And then like literally in an hour, they'll send you a spreadsheet and you're like, fabulous, let's do this work. In Ukraine, this required the physician, a labor of love to literally put masking tape over the names of every single medical record that was in the hospital because there are federal rules against sharing the, I mean, like their name is just on the top of it. It's a huge violation of medical privacy. And like literally going through thousands of records that way with a bunch of RAs with papers in front of them, typing into REDCap and then delicately removing all the masking tape. It took weeks. And so that's the kind of infrastructure that they are attempting to move services into, right? So when I say there was potential, I think there was a huge leap in getting folks, online and ready to do this kind of stuff and able to accept telemedicine. Whether telemedicine is happening is a bigger question for me now. If I would love to have been this summer in Ukraine and be able to go and see it and tell you, I wasn't able to. The Ministry of Health right now is not communicating a lot about that. And that's a question then that I don't know how to fully answer without going. I will say though that answering the question of how are we getting access and care to the most vulnerable people, I would actually back up a step and say that we need to actually understand who the most vulnerable people are. And while we can understand those folks in the abstract, you know, pensioners, the elderly, those with chronic diseases, so on and so forth, we don't actually always know who those people are. There's no centralized epidemiology. If you have everything on paper, like how are you supposed to know how many people actually had cancer last year? Like there's literally no way to do it. And so there was a goal, one of the goals of the original healthcare reform was to set up a centralized electronic medical records system so that you could do that kind of chart review activity with the whole country. And when I heard this idea, I was like, oh, that's the coolest thing ever. And you know, tons of countries have actually tried to set that up and have failed to do it. I think that is languishing. I think that they kind of like started putting together tenders to get it done and then change of leadership and it never got put forward. So we will have to see if any of these mechanisms actually came to fruition, but it's extremely hard to know if those mechanisms are actually doing the job that they're supposed to do. One of the other things that Supruun told me during the conversation that we had in 2019 was that they have actually set a number of quality improvement and outcome indicators for the healthcare reform, but have no way to monitor those indicators, right? And she was like, if someone from an American university just wants to show up with a bunch of money and like evaluate this stuff, like open doors, we'll bring lunch. Of course, she's no longer in the Ministry of Health. I do not know, and I doubt that that invitation is still standing, but that was a major concern they had at the time as well.
Thank you. I'm going to read out Marina Vitrova's question, and then Betsy Fawcett has a question. She's going to jump on. So Marina is an addiction psychiatrist from Russia, and she says, how would you answer the question about the main factor which turned Ukraine's health system to accept agonist opioid treatment? Am I reading that right? Using your medical shorthand that us non-medical anthropologists don't know. So agonist opioid treatment as an option for opioid addiction care, while Russia doesn't believe in this kind of treatment.
Right. So I want to note, she may or may not be available, but Alyona Majnaya is on the call. And so if she has anything to add, I want to invite her to unmute herself and come on, because she is someone who significant portions of my book exist because that woman helped me find data and understand what's going on. She was working with the Alliance for a long time, was on the ground. She managed to be in like three places at once. She was like the Hermione Granger of harm reduction in Ukraine, and is now a highly successful PhD epidemiologist, postdocing at Yale. She was present for a lot of this, but my understanding keeps growing as I meet more and more people and get more sort of like backwards views on things, was that there was a very, very concerted effort by foreign agents to bring this kind of medication into Ukraine, partially because Ukraine was experiencing a documented massive HIV epidemic among people who use drugs. And I believe that it was happening. I'm less familiar with epidemiologic history in Russia. I believe that the timeline happened fairly similarly, that they happened kind of on top of each other. But I know that Ukraine, especially, like, the epidemiology was being done, the testing was being done, and folks really knew how urgent the situation was. So medications for opioid use disorder, I could go on about this forever, but the very short version of the story is that they're pharmacological interventions that are provided to people who are opioid dependent, and they have been scientifically proven to dramatically reduce early and accidental death, to reduce overdose, to reduce cravings. It's not inappropriate to, I believe, to compare them to like the Nicorette gum or a nicotine patch for smoking. Is that so? There's this thing that you have a physical dependency on, and that physical dependency is causing chaotic use and relationships out in the world. So if we just provide it to you in a pharmaceutically stable and safe way, then like you can sort of settle your life down and figure out everything that's happening, and not fight with your body, not fight through the withdrawals, but also you're not going outside for a smoke break every 5 minutes, and you're not like leaving your job to go pick up drugs and things of that nature. So there was a push to bring it into Ukraine for that reason. I would believe that that similar efforts were happening in Russia at the same time, of folks being like, hey, can we pilot this? Can we try it? And I'm learning actually more and more that Dr. Rick Altice at Yale has had his hand in some of this stuff for a very, very long time. So historians of HIV in Ukraine, call Rick. He's in New Haven. He has two cute kids and would probably love to talk to you about it and put the kids on the camera at the same time. But like, these are folks who were literally going around to different oblast health commissioners and things that, like, basically asking like, can we start piloting this? For some reason, they found an opportunity in Ukraine. And then against that, or like underneath that opportunity in Ukraine, there emerged a lot of civil society organizations, many of which also exist in Russia, to do harm reduction and advocacy for people who use drugs. But those folks appeared to buoy up those programs. Once those programs sort of became feasible and operational, the Global Fund moved in and then dumped tens of millions of dollars on Ukraine to keep buying that medication. So I think really the major difference, I think Ukraine and Russia could be on identical trajectories right now, if not for a lot of people who were just poised to jump on that program right as it opened and to keep it alive. I think it was a lot of circumstantial things. I'm really glad that it was open. I think there's been a lot of, there's still a lot of room for improvement in how that care is delivered. Access is still way too low. There's gotta be something close to 80,000-90,000 people in Ukraine living with active opioid use disorder right now. And we have fewer than, I think, 15,000 treatment slots at current. That might even be a generous estimate. So there's definitely room for improvement, but it seems like a very path-driven thing. Like it was a coincidental collection of people and opportunities and money that just came together in Ukraine and didn't come together in Russia. Because as was mentioned in the question, the view by most leadership in public health in Russia is that these medications are harmful. You can't even import them for other reasons, which to me is kind of funny, because methadone, one of these medications, is actually really good at treating lots of other things other than opioid use disorder. It's really good for like neuropathic pain, things like that, they're seen as sort of social threats, and that opinion, that point of view, is certainly prevalent in Ukraine, right? But the infrastructure to do this for those who are willing to do it has been created. And I think it's just the unique history of that unique place. It is a particular that emerged from a particular context. Yeah.
Hi, Jennifer. So I'm wondering about the education metric of the reforms. I'm wondering how much progress has been made on that reform goal and what it kind of looks like. I would assume that it would be something that would take a little bit longer because you have to change the curriculum, you have to get better, you know, teaching staff, you have to train a whole new generation of doctors. So I'm wondering how that's going. But then I also wonder if there's a stratification in kind of the quality of education for doctors who are living in the city versus doctors who are living in rural areas. And I know Emily sort of started mentioning this, and I think it's an interesting part of the conversation.
Yeah, so that is actually not my area. I've not been following medical education, and I'm not actually quite sure how licensing, if that actually ever even happened. I've been really focusing on the changes to primary care. And so I think I'll tell you who I would go to answer this question. That would be folks like Marina Vasilievich-Nading. It would be folks like Alyona Majnaya. It would be folks like Tim Flanagan and Natasha Rybak at Brown University, who have active relationships with people working in medical education in Ukraine, who have actually had the opportunity to see things on the ground. Because as we know, Ukraine has taught us time and time again that things existing on paper don't always exist in reality, right? So I think this is why I'm so heartbroken by this summer, right? That none of us could actually go and see our friends and loved ones, but it really requires walking into the medical university with a box of chocolates and a notepad and asking people what's happening to truly answer those questions. So I think there are some people on this call who have been able to do that or have been in direct contact with people who have been able to do that, I would turn to them. But I want to know as desperately as you do, honestly.
Hi. Hi, Jen. This is Alyona. You called me.
Hi.
You never know. You joined this.
I'm not trying to pressure her, but I guess I'm pressuring her to.
No. It's just you joined this webinars to listen and learn, and then you are prepared to talk. So thank you for the question about MAT and in Ukraine and Russia. And it's actually a very interesting story in terms of how it started, because now we can see, because it was marketed and pushed as HIV prevention treatment primarily, not as substance use disorder treatment, now we face challenges with scaling up it and introducing it into primary health care. Because oftentimes what we hear back from non-specialist doctors saying, this is the HIV prevention thing, why a AIDS center can take care of that, and the counter argument being actually it's a treatment for substance use disorder regardless like of all other multitude benefits for the infectious disease. So that's something as of like unintended consequences of initial decisions, but I guess at that time it was the only way through to push through this medicine. It was not possible at that time to introduce it as a substance use disorder treatment. So something to think about for the places and settings which try to introduce. And another thing that is actually very interesting about Ukraine in terms of methadone and buprenorphine, because buprenorphine has been introduced as like the first line, as the first drug, and the methadone was introduced a little bit later. And when we see in the data worldwide that the retention on methadone is usually better, in Ukraine is actually the opposite. Retention on buprenorphine is better because it's perceived as more limited drug and more elite drug, just because it was the initial offering that they did not scale up buprenorphine to the extent that they scaled up methadone. And the last third thing to mention is now there are a lot of efforts to diversify those programs, including take-home prescriptions, including providing it through primary healthcare. Actually, you mentioned Rick, and he has a lot of projects for that, to trying to make it a part of the routine care and part, since the health service is willing to pay for that package. But challenge again with that, again with the unintended consequences, since when we were pushing for this program using international donor funding, kind of money were not a big obstacle. When the National Health Service of Ukraine tries to quantify the cost of that services, unfortunately, the budget may not allow for that flexibility as we used to have within research projects, within implementation and scale-up projects.
Right. And that was also, I think, I mean, we had this conversation at the time, but I think that was part of the motivation, at least as I understood it, behind the changes to Order 200, the national law that regulated MAT. There was a chunk of time in which those medications were only available to people who had two documented failures in like traditional therapy, which is like talking to your priest or whatever, and which is particularly devastating for me because I'm like, you know what relapse look like? It looks like unintentional overdose. Like, that's frightening that they would make people do that. And there was a huge pushback against it. And the public health alliance that Aliona was working for at the time did just a commendable job making arguments and corresponding with it's a lobbying masterclass. But part of the understanding was that the global fund kept kind of looking at the Ministry of Health and being like, y'all are going to have to do this. Like, hey, we set up this multi-million-dollar program in your country. When are you going to start paying the tab? And the Ministry of Health is like, how do we artificially limit people coming into this program because we can't fund it? The fact that they did not care about the well-being of people who use drugs, I think, just made enforcing those limitations a little bit easier. But yeah, the fact that that it can be so expensive to take on was a major, major issue. Yeah. Thank you, Aliona. Come visit me in Carolina. I would love to have you.
Well, I'm in Ukraine now.
Oh, man, I'm so jealous. Okay, well, we will soon get together for coffee.
Yes, for sure.
And I would love to invite everybody here to sign up for our book club, which is at its end in terms of the reading process. But Dr. Carroll will be joining us at the same time again tomorrow to talk more about her book research. And you might see my cat again as well. But if you're interested in digging deeper into these topics, it's okay if you haven't read the book. Even if you're just interested, I think it'll be another great discussion. We're at the end of our time, kind of at the end of our questions. I want to thank everybody for coming. Thanks for sharing. Thank you so much, Jen, for such an interesting conversation, and just, I think, giving us a wealth of things to think about for anybody who's interested in future research. I mean, as much as information as you already shared, I think we've also uncovered a lot of future questions that need to be answered. And so I know people are here from all kinds of different backgrounds, and I think that's great to start that conversation so that we have a real multidisciplinary understanding of the effects of these reforms. Thanks to everybody on the webinar. Thanks to everybody on our YouTube channel. Let me please take one more second of your time. Some of you may recall that we had some technical difficulties a few weeks ago in our seminar with Julia Buiskich. We are very excited to announce that we'll be streaming a video of her lecture next Wednesday at noon, and she'll be able to join us for a conversation. So I'll send it all of you here, even if you weren't signed up before, an invitation to that discussion. Please feel free to join us. She'll be talking about, her title is Without Records, and she's talking about how anthropologists deal with silence. So for anthropologists, I think it'll be a really great conversation. Please look out for that email. Please feel free to join us tomorrow. I really encourage you. It'll be very similar to this, only more focused on Jen's amazing research on drug use and health.
I'll try to bring my cat too.
Yeah, please your cat. Everybody gets extra credit for their pets joining. Let's thanks Jen again. It was really great to see you. It was really great to hear, and nice to see everybody here as well. Thank you so much.
Yeah, thank you to Huri. You guys do such a good job bringing community together around this. I'm so grateful for your existence, and y'all are the best. Thank you.